Well, yes, this is the Beer Lounge. I'm Lissa Gibbs, and I'm an advisor to the Napa Valley Film Festival. I am the... Oh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, we will go with the microphone. That makes it a little bit easier. We are sharing microphones, but and we as women who know how to work together, we're very good at sharing. This is Women Behind the Lens, and we're going to be exploring that topic in some depth this morning. I'm an advisor to the film festival, a longtime educator, nonprofit administrator working in the media arts, former film festival director, outgoing director of the foundations for Napa Valley College, and the incoming director of advancement for the Sakatar Foundation. So I have a slightly different perspective on all of this and have made some choices in my life, but I am very much part of a production family and in the throes of the industry all the time, being married to someone and raising children with someone who works on location all the time. I want to introduce my esteemed panelists. It's a great group of women. I did ask the festival, come on, can't we have some men on this panel next year, because this is not a women's issue. And we will be talking about that, so it's nice to see the men folk in the audience, because this is an issue for all of us. And I think that we're discovering that every day. To my immediate left is Elise Perlstein. She's a senior VP of Participant Media. Next to her is Tess Harrison, a filmmaker, writer, actor, producer, director, out of a recent transplant from New York and now in Los Angeles as of 2 months ago. She's here in the festival with a short called It's Perfect Here. Gren Wells, who is a juror in this year's festival, and the director of The Road Within, an amazing individual, actor, producer, make things happen kind of lady.
And writer, director.
No. Yeah, writer, director,
producer. No more acting.
Well, wait. But you were an actor for a long time. then we have Jesse Nelson, director of Love the Coopers, great, great film that everyone is saying wonderful things about, and director of other films as well. We'll hear a little bit more from her. Jeannie Mao, with the microphone in her hand, who's a vice president of diversity at CBS Entertainment. And then Kristen Wallace, originally out of Toronto, now out of Los Angeles, an actor, writer, producer, and she's here with the film Moments of Clarity. Yay.
Yeah, nice career.
So you're looking at a lot of experience up here and a lot of insight. First, we're not going to get into detail about, you know, is there a problem with sexism and racism in the entertainment industry. I think that particularly the big things that have happened in the last year, like Gamergate, the ongoing Bill Cosby situation, the issues of date rape on campus, really point to a problem within our society and in our world that is sometimes reinforced by media, sometimes addressed by media, and sometimes not. We have big examples, but we also have small examples, those small things that happen. This morning, I dropped off my two daughters, who are ages 10 and 12, at their robotics competition that they've been preparing for. And they're on a team, there's six girls and one boy, and my older daughter said, yeah, these shirts they got for us, there's just one boy, and they ordered boy shirts. What is that about? And it's things like that that I think, you know, in some ways, that is the problem. And how we address that. So why does equity matter? I mean, I want to start with you, Jeannie. What's your job? And did your job exist 10 years ago? And what do you do in your work?
So my job did exist 10 years ago, but I think the research didn't. And what I do at CBS is I run a writers and directors program for emerging writers and directors who are looking to break into television. These are diverse directors, and these are women writers and directors. So we do everything on that front, and we work alongside with the Writers Guild, DGA, the Gina Davis Foundation, Google, all the other networks when it comes to what is the research saying, what's the call to action. We also work internally with CBS when it has anything to do with a subject matter that might be sensitive to the community. So they come to us when there's a specific topic or an issue that we want to make sure that we're depicting somebody correctly, or we're calling them what they want to be called correctly. So what we do on the diversity front is pretty much across the board, try to move the dial in the right direction.
So what's the incentive for a business to do something like that?
It's good business sense. For instance, little things that we do. We get scripts. We get all the scripts. One thing we tell our showrunners is, don't make the medical examiner or the sheriff what you think it is. They're not all 50-year-old white men. Put a Latina woman in there. Like, how would that change creatively? And it really doesn't. But what it does is it normalizes for the audience what it's supposed to look like. It empowers girls to believe, like, I can be a sheriff. I can be a medical examiner. I can be a judge. So once we start normalizing what we see in television, it becomes, we don't need to have these conversations. The Gina Davis Foundation did a research study in terms of crowds. Little things we can do as filmmakers. Crowds in 120 movies, 17% women. The population of women is 49%. We can do little things by normalizing what we want to see. And it's not F the man. It's like, how do we as women change what the makeup of what we create looks like? Your crews, you should have all female PAs. You're below the lines. We're your first 80s that are women. If you don't have any, I can get you some. You know, it's little things in terms of, like, we need to band together as women to figure out what the solution is, because he's not. And while there may be a lot of men that's going to jump on and support us, we need to do it collectively. And we need to make sure that we're depicting what we want our children to know exist. Especially in television and in films. How are we depicting women? Who are we employing? These things. So this is what we try to do at CBS across the board, not just within our network, but just across the board.
So we jump to that as a solution immediately, and I think that each of the women here on this panel have done their own versions of that. Gran, you want to take that?
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say,
Matt Damon said that casting the show, should that's not diversity. You know, I mean, that what he said on Project Runway, or Project Greenlight. It was ridiculous, because when I crewed up for my movie, it was the first thing I did. I was like, I want women, I want, you know, like, and we did have all female PAs.
Which is great.
So, I think it makes a huge difference.
It does. And we post to the DGA. So I meet with the DGA pretty much every month in terms of what their outreach is, what they need to do, what we need to see in terms of increasing the female director pool, because it's 13%. It's like, oh, it's awful. It's awful. And I asked them, like, do a study and follow shows that are hiring female PAs and watch where their career takes off, because that's the closest pipeline you can get into to becoming a director or becoming a first AD. Like, start at the bottom and let's follow these women and see what kind of impact we can make. Because other than yelling at different networks and, like, hire them, and they're saying, no, it's the agent's fault and it's the showrunner, like, then what do we need to do? Well, let's start populating what our crew looks like. Let's start populating what our cast looks like. Let's give them larger and stronger speaking roles. Let's stop victimizing them. Things like that.
So what about who controls the money in terms of, you know, the gender and ethnicity of where the money's flowing from? When you're looking for investors, when you're looking for, you know, that executive producer. We have a lot of executive producers who are women. What are they saying, and how do we change the conversation around that? What are the solutions to that? And Elise, you probably have some thoughts about that. You want to jump on that one?
I'm not sure I have thoughts about that specifically, but I do think that it's important to have, as important as it is to have women, you know, at every level of crews, it's also important to have women as executives and decision makers.
Right.
You know, sometimes that means actually kind of green lighting and giving the money, but I also think it takes women in positions of power to recognize other women who are doing the work and give them kind of the attention that they deserve. And I mean, that to me personally, it took women kind of pushing me a little bit out in front to kind of get recognition for what I had been doing for a long time. And so, you know, I think that as my, in my position as an executive now, I was a filmmaker for a long time and now I'm an executive, I am trying to kind of do that same thing, you know, look at, you know, both in terms of content that we'd support, but also recognizing the roles of the people who are already working and making sure, I mean, there are little things like making sure the producer gets invited to the premiere, that the producer is standing up for the Q&A. Well, the producer's often a woman. so, you know, when you're looking at filmmaking teams, a lot of, you know, it's very kind of director-centric. There'll be a lot of focus on, you know, the one person without recognition of the team that makes the film. So, you know, every opportunity I have to try to push forward the people who, you know, tend to kind of step back and be in the service of the project, you know, to say, you need to be up there too. So it's the visibility thing in a similar way, but I do think that it takes people who have a little bit more authority to kind of push them forward.
Do women have a responsibility of advocating for themselves?
No.
That's an interesting question.
Is that hard?
Yeah.
I think it's hard with money.
I think it's hard. That is such a tricky question, because my answer is yes, obviously women have to advocate for themselves, but also women shouldn't have to advocate for themselves, so it feels like a double-edged sword, that there's, you know, I don't want to say this is who I am and this is my art and this is what I do and take it a step further because I'm a woman and I'm disenfranchised in this industry right now, but also that's true, so we have to be aware of all these powers that be and how they influence what gets made and who gets the money and who's standing up at the Q&A. And kind of just be kind of self-aware of all of the things that are influencing the decisions are made. So I guess that answers your question, I'm not sure.
Jesse, do you want to? I mean, we've got a director who's made a major, you know, motion picture that's coming out. It's going to be the big film of the holiday season. How did you fall into that role of being the director, and how did you shift the work culture to support you and to support what you were doing?
I started as an actress, and that life of auditioning all day long was not satisfying for me creatively, so I segued into writing so I could sort of be creative all day long, and then quickly realized that Dorothy Parker quote, writers are the women of Hollywood, you know, that that you had no power as a writer, no voice as a writer. You know, the first script I wrote was about five waitresses on New Year's Eve. It was a kind of a female diner. They fired me off it quickly. Five different men rewrote it. It became very misogynistic. So I taught myself how to direct by making a short film. And that led to my first feature.
What kind of support did you get doing that? And did you feel like you needed it?
I had tremendous support from my husband.
Yay!
And who's also a filmmaker. And I felt I had to find it within myself. I felt that it was that the deepest work I could do would be to, I love this Hal Ashby quote, films are made, they're willed into existence. And I thought, if I just find that will in me, and I've learned that it doesn't matter how many no's you get. If one person says yes to your movie, then your movie's made. You know, so for me, Carina took 11 years. I Am Sam took 9 years. This movie I just made took 4 years. That just became, I wanted to break the paradigm for myself of like waiting to be asked to the dance, which I think a lot of women can get into. Oh, I want them to offer me the scripts. I want, you know, to be offered the job. I just let that go and thought, I'll create the job. I'll make the film, I'll get it made. And it wasn't even, you know, it was just a mind shift of saying, I want to make films, I'm going to figure out how to make films. And that's what I really encourage young filmmakers to do, men and women. Mm-hmm. You know, I think the more you can take the reins creatively, the better. So yeah, I do think we have a responsibility, because I, you know, if you wait for the solution, if you wait to solve the problem, it won't get solved. You have to become the solution to the problem.
I was in a shorts program in this room a couple days ago, and There was a woman, the director, she's Icelandic, and she had made Zelos. And she was out of the, you know, women's directing initiative. And she said, well, you know, that's been going on since the 70s. And I thought, oh, wow. Yeah, it's still really needed. You know, this has been a long time. You know, how do we get it to the next level? How do we, you know, they always, in every other situation, you know, the most important thing is acknowledgement, you know, and it seems like we're still at that acknowledgement
yeah.
phase, you know, like the whole Cosby thing. It's really about, you know, this still goes on. What more do we need to do to acknowledge the problem so that we can get to those substantive solutions? And Gran, you probably...
Everything you just said rings so true to me, because I had a really successful career as a writer for the past 15 years and always wanted to direct, and everyone just kept saying, no, like this person who has so much more experience would be better for your script and it's not. And then they'd fuck it up. So I was like, well, I can't do any worse. And so I finally found a piece of material that I went out with my husband and we optioned, and I spec'd the script and did all this. And then this financier said, well, why should I let you direct it? I said, because I own the motherfucking rights. Why should I let you finance it? So, like, it is about taking control yourself. No one could take those rights away from me. So you just have to do it yourself. And then when it's good enough, people will want to finance it. And so that was...
Kristen, I think, is dying to say something down there.
Well, I mean, I think it's so amazing to see all these women on this panel right now. It's great to see the representation of what you want to continue to do and these really strong voices. And I think there is becoming more and more of that, and more encouragement to do your own and to create from the ground up. And really, like, you know, I don't know what it was like in the 50s, and I know that things really, the numbers in film have not changed really since then, like with the amount of women in scenes and women behind the camera and all that sort of stuff. But for all I know is right now, and I do feel like there is such a strong connection with women of wanting to build each other up and encouraging each other to start writing so that you can be the director, so that you can be the producer, so that you can hire everybody you want. And so, I mean, that's what I wanted to do, and I had a lot of encouragement from different females, and I made sure that at least 50% of my crew was female, and at least 50% of my cast was female, and that the lead females in my movie were, you know, could easily have been males. And so I think that's like something that I would love to continue to do is, you know, and like you were saying, kind of flip those sort of stereotypical roles or characters like on their head and say, and so when people are watching it, they're like, oh wow, I could, you know, these women are so different. It's because you'd probably normally see two men doing what they're doing. And that's really cool, you know? And that's something that I think, you know, I've gotten as a response from our film, and which is so amazing because that's what I set out to do. So, and I think, you know, my co-star Lindsay is, you know, is just an example of somebody who, instead of seeing me as somebody who, as a threat or something, or as her competition or whatever, she has been like my number one advocate. So I think those are the small things that make a huge difference, that we're a collective voice and that we're, you know, building each other up.
So how do we shift those norms? I mean, very specifically, I mean, we're kind of talking about quotas on one level. I make sure that there's half, and that's a start. But I think that all of you would say you always hire the best person for the job. Well, how are you defining best? And what does it mean maybe to have someone with less experience but who's a strong communicator? You know, that paradigm of the work that gets done on a set, in development, and in distribution. you know, the complex animal, which is a life, the public life of a film. You know, it gets developed, which is kind of private. Then it gets made, which is like excruciating, like childbirth. And then it goes out in the world like a teenager going off, you know, to the first time their year abroad and out into the world. How do we move beyond quotas and shift to new norms of working that really allow people, men and women, of all different backgrounds, economic backgrounds, racial, ethnic, cultural backgrounds, how do we get them to feel included? And what are the ways of working in the film industry that do that? What are some practices that you all have done? Jesse?
One of my most moving experiences for me was on I Am Sam, all of our PAs were disabled. And
what was that like, finding, okay, you know, like, we're gonna look for disabled PAs. Where'd you do that? Like, how do you do that?
I had done research at a place called LA Goal. That's where Sean Penn and I went to observe and work with all the disabled people. And so we just brought them on the set with us. And I mean, the funniest thing for me was Sean Penn came up to me because he was being an angel on the set, and everyone had said he was so difficult and he was so dear. And he came up to me and he said, "Fuck you for hiring all these disabled people. I can't act out. I would be such a dick." Acted out in front of these people whose struggles are so deep. And then I realized, like, it was like having all these angels on the set. Like, it just brought everybody up to such a good place. So I don't ever think it's specifically about you have to hire women, you have to hire minorities, you have to hire this. I think you really have to hire what's at the soul of your project, like what you're examining or exploring or trying to bring forward into the world. Even on this last movie I made, you know, we had a lot of older actors, and so I hired a lot of older PAs, people that hadn't worked in a long time, just because it was great to have some 7-year-olds and 80-year-olds.
Did you ever get pushback? Someone said, you know, the liability, the insurance, our insurance is going to go up because those people are going to be, like, you know, dying on us in the set.
I mean, you always get pushback. You just
so what do you do?
I understand how you're feeling. I'm going to do it anyway. You know, you have to just keep moving forward. You just have to keep, you know, your sense of intention and moving forward. And people, if the idea is right, there's a great quote by Norman Mailer, "Everything moves towards the right idea." If the idea is right, people will get on board with it. They'll feel it. And so I think it's about, and my whole thing, like early on, I'm not a particularly confident person. I'm a very shy person, a very quiet person. And I had a brilliant female therapist who said, you know, you want to direct, you want all these things, you're never going to be confident. You had too weird a childhood. Give up on being confident. Just fake it.
Was it liberating?
Yeah, she said, fake confidence and confidence will follow. Just fake it, you know, and you'll start living the life that you want to live, and through that, hopefully confidence will follow. And I encourage a lot of that with women and men, you know, that it's hard. You can lose your confidence. You can have a lot of no's. It can make you compress yourself. And if you just sort of fake a determination, then sort of you go, yeah, you know, I can do it, you know, and you kind of just do it. And I think that's so much of changing the norms is not letting fear stop you at all. And I know women can get caught in that, you know. Well, everyone can get caught in that you know, diminishing themselves in some way. And so I think that's, for me, that's a big part of it. And if I can give any message to young filmmakers, it's to just, like, keep going, you know.
I think Elise wants to jump in on this, because I think that probably a lot of your role in nurturing and bringing up talent.
Well, I think there's something kind of odd about thinking that it's a compromise, you know, that to hire a woman is somehow a compromise. You know, in a lot of the things I've done, you know, I've done documentaries. And, you know, when we're telling a certain story, I know that the camera person has to be a woman and that the sound person has to be a woman.
How do you know that?
Well, if the story is centered around any material that's sensitive. I mean, I'm looking at what environment are we going to create for these people, you know, we're already invading their privacy, busting into their house, you know, doing whatever we're doing, it's uncomfortable. And so what can I do to kind of facilitate an environment where people are gonna wanna be open and honest? And, you know, I have found in numerous situations that having having a female camera woman, you know, behind the lens, it is just changes the dynamic 100%. And there are a few, you know, but then also, you know, one of my favorite camera women is, she's just an amazing camera woman. So I also bring her Shauna Hagen. She's a great documentary cinematographer. And you know, she has these like for documentary stuff, you have people who know how to set up the camera, but then you also, when you're trying to shoot verite, you know, things that are happening, you need to have somebody who's listening, who's intuitive, and who's following that kind of emotional, you know, the emotional development in a scene. And not that men can't do it, but, you know, I worked with this male cameraman who was, you know, it's always tweaking the lens and the lighting, and he's not listening. You know, so there's this incredible stuff happening, and he's like shooting a tree, you know. So I think it's getting the experience of knowing what works for the story that you're telling. But I think that if you're, you know, for me, finding incredible, skilled, you know, cinematographers and sound recordists who are also women, is just a kind of, it's an added benefit. It's not a compromise.
Tess, you want to say something about how you're working? Because the approach that you guys are coming at your things, talk a little bit about your work.
I came to filmmaking as an actress. I worked for an actress for a long time, and I still do. And this was my first short film that I wrote and directed and acted in. And we produced, my two producers are here, Hannah and Maria. And we came to filmmaking all as actors and said, we need to be creating our own roles. There's not enough here. There's not enough true and deep female characters for us to play, so let's do it ourselves. And so collectively, we shot three shorts in 1 week, and we brought one crew to one location. So we had 5 shooting days and about 30 pages of script to do. And our DP was switching aspect ratios halfway through the day. And it was kind of a crash course in filmmaking and acting and directing and producing all at the same time. But it was quite fun and wonderful and really important, I felt like, to have the three of us working together as women to create this content for ourselves that we totally did all the jobs for. And then after doing that, you're like, okay, this is why you don't do all the jobs. Usually there's somebody else doing that work so you can focus on something while you're, you know, trying to get everything done. But that was how we came up with this project, and we'd like to kind of package these shorts at some point and, you know, put them out together, because it's an interesting story to have three different scripts all in the same location. They're all very different, they all look very different. But the trio of the production and the story of how everything was made, I think, is unique and a testament to all of this work that everyone up here is doing of advocacy and just do it. There's no reason to stop. And the only way that you're ever gonna get anything done as any type of person in any field is to do it yourself. And then also to be able to say, I did this and this is how I did it. I've gotten only incredible reactions from everyone here who I've met. They say, wow, that's so awesome that you did that, and congratulations, and now I'm really interested in your piece, and I really want to check it out, send it to me, or whatever. But the self-discipline that it takes to really just get it done on your own, I feel like is really impressive.
But the on your own,
yeah,
is actually a collective.
Right, yeah.
You know, and that's a really great way. The efficiency through collective. Mm-hmm. I think documentary filmmakers have known that for a while.
They don't have enough money.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and sometimes you can, the blood you squeeze out of the turnip is the tastiest, you know. Jeannie, I'm watching you down there.
No, it's so exciting to hear all these wonderful things. And back to your point in terms of the collective, as I said before, once we start normalizing it, women don't have to ask permission, and people aren't allowed to say, well, she's a big risk. Well, so is anything else in terms of risk. So what we do at CBS is try to avert those risks. One thing that I wanted to mention is, once we start normalizing it, like we started normalizing everyone thinking they were DNA experts, and universities started exploding in medical examiners and criminologists and DNA experts when we launched CSI. Mm-hmm. When we launched CSI, everyone became a DNA expert. Audiences knew what was happening, and universities called us to be like, what's going on? We need to open up schools within our university to teach students something no one really knew or understand or heard of before. And then we realized, like, we can be impactful in that way. We can be impactful in a negative way as well. So how do we change that dialogue, and how do we make a difference? One is empowering women, and we go to universities and we go to elementary schools to let them know, like, ask for help, women. Ask for help. It's not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of strength. And number two, the idea of it being risk is no different than it being a risk if it was for a man who has the same amount of experience. So I think we need to stop asking permission and going in and asking, because a guy would, and if he got a no, he would go somewhere else to get that yes. And I think as women and as multitaskers and as parents and as a parent of children who are girls, it's really important to empower them and to allow them to understand that it's okay if we can't do it all, but we have to try. And we have to try collectively as opposed to clawing each other. And you know, it's definitely important, because what we've seen, especially out of the Women's Steering Committee at the DGA, is some of the struggles they get is there's a scarcity where shows are like, well, we have our one or two women, but that's not acceptable. You can't check. It's not about a box to check. When we're at parity at 50-50, then we can say we've checked that box when it comes to television directing. So it's really changing the dialogue, where shows that have been on for me for a long time, and we have our diverse director, or we have our female, is it 50-50? No, then you don't have it, because it doesn't represent what we're trying to obtain. So it's different things in terms of changing the unconscious bias of what people think is, I got my three diverse. That's not, unconsciously, it's wrong, and they think they're doing a good thing, but I think it's really changing the dialogue to say, what's your crew look like? Is just your script supervisor a woman? Because that's not acceptable. The chicks can do guy jobs. You just need to mentor them, you need to empower them, and you need to hire them from the very start. There's not a lot of inventory. Well, find it. They exist. So things like that, in terms of helping the industry understand that we need to do better, and it's not about boxes to be checked off, it's about parity.
I think that's so incredible, everything that you guys are doing. I think the thing is that there's not enough people like aware of those sorts of programs and like the movement that, you know, you guys are working on at CBS, because I even found when we were crewing up for our movie, and I really wanted to find like a female director so badly. It was now I'm like, oh my god, we need to connect, because I couldn't find like any females. Everybody who was submitting to us were men, and it was scary to me at first, because you know, I had a story that is about two females, and it is, you know, it's written by a female, and I'm producing it, and very, very much, you know, I was inspired by Gina Davis, you know, when I was young with A League of Their Own and Thelma and Louise and stuff like that, of seeing these like really cool kick-ass women like on screen and that were different, and they weren't just talking about men, and you know, and so you know, I thought I really needed a female director to help have that sort of sensitivity to that this type of story. And I mean, you know, I was lucky enough that my director I found was right for this project, and it, you know, he has the sensitivity of a woman. we cried multiple times on set together. He helped me. But you know, like, and so he was the best person for the job. But I think the hard part, and when I was watching Project Greenlight, and Matt Damon said that comment, I think the problem is that the females that I saw coming in on that show that were directors, they're just not getting the opportunities at the very beginning. And in general, women aren't, you know, even as myself as an actress, I felt the roles were so horrible that I was reading, and the representation of women was so horrible. And then even in my university, when I was doing, we would do our Shakespearean plays, there's one female, and they never ever like decided to change some of the other roles to females. They didn't need to be men. I think they did it once. You know, one of the roles I played in The Tempest was a man before, you know, and that was, and then we had three females in that play, and the females were by far way more talented than the men, but they weren't getting the opportunities. I had to say that. But I think that was the hard part for me when I was starting to develop, you know, my feature, is that I just felt like women weren't getting the opportunities from like the very beginning. So then they're not being hired because they're not, they don't have the experience, but you know, it's that catch 22 in the industry. It's, I know
Grant's gonna have something to say about this, and also if you could start talking about mentors. Being one, finding one, how do you find one, how do you be one, and why is it important?
Okay, I do wanna say something to that though, because as a writer, I know I've gotten jobs because I'm a woman, and I've also not gotten jobs because I'm a woman, but I was always able to develop my own stuff, and you know, it wasn't ever really that big an issue. And I was interviewed on NPR about it, and I was like, as soon as my movie was coming out, and everything was great, we were getting awards and this and that, I was like, everything is awesome. I don't know what the problem is. And cut to a year later, and I have gone in on jobs with male producers, and I remember this one, I walk in and I had this great pitch, I had like visuals and this and that. He puts his pen down, and I'm thinking, oh, okay, he's just gonna listen. And then at the end, there were no questions, and he's like, thank you for coming in. I went, I was never even in contention because I have a vagina. Like, and it made me so angry. And I gave a job to a guy, and it was one of those things where I was like, oh my God. And once again, so my next project I wrote again by myself, and you know, and we're doing it independently, because I will prove to them that they have to hire me. And I don't care how many times I have to do it, because I'll fucking throw it in their face and just say, you know, I am a valid director who the studio should hire. So, you know, and it's the Colin Trevorrow thing, if you guys know, you know, he went from Directing Safety Not Guaranteed to Jurassic World. And it's not happening for women. And so it's something that now I see is extremely frustrating. But once again, I'll keep moving forward.
Gren, do you have a mentor?
I do.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
His name is Bruce Gilbert. He produced a couple little movies called Coming Home, China Syndrome, 9 to 5, On Golden Pond. And he is a god. I met him at a party. I didn't even know who he was. And you know, I'm not good like going like, oh yeah, you work at so-and-so, whatever. I just walked around and was like, hi, I'm Gren, who are you? And he was like, oh, I'm Bruce. I was like, what do you do, Bruce? He's like, I'm a retired producer. I was like, what'd you produce? And he listed these movies. I'm like, fuck. So I follow him around the party and make him tell me stories about Katharine Hepburn and Jane Fonda. And then at the end of the night, he said, you know, you're awfully persistent. I was like, yeah, you know. And he goes, no, that's good, because I've been looking for, you know, somebody to mentor. And I was like, oh my God. And this was before, like, I was just acting and doing stand-up at that point. I hadn't written anything. And he's like, so, you know, what ideas do you have? And I said, well, I have an idea for a funny cancer movie. And this is before cancer is all the rage, by the way. So, and so he goes, okay, great. Get me a treatment by Wednesday. This was Friday night. And I go home, I'm like, what the fuck is a treatment? I don't know. And I can't ask him now, because I pretended like I knew what I was talking about. So I just sat down and I wrote the script. And it was something like 180 pages, which is way, way too long for a script. And I handed it to him on Wednesday, and he goes, I thought you said you didn't have a script. I was like, I know, but I was too embarrassed to tell you I didn't know how to write a treatment. And then he ended up, like, he read it, and he said it was one of the best first drafts he'd ever read, and he mentored me through the process, and he was so amazing, because he also never said, change this, or don't do this, or whatever. He would tell me stories about things that he had done in his career, and how he came up with ideas how to fix things. And at one point, because I would always turn the script around in like 24 hours, and he'd be like, Jesus Christ, give me a second. I just read the last one yesterday.
And so he gave me this one note. He goes, have them meet on the internet. Now, this is like kind of at the beginning of the internet, kind of that'll date me, but I was like, ew, what are you talking about? And he said, just do it, just try it. And so I was like, okay, you're the expert. And I did, and it took me like a week. And, you know, so I turned it back in. I was like, I hate it. I don't think it works. He was like, I know. I was like, what do you mean you know? He goes, I wanted you to realize that you can do anything with your characters and you can always go back to what you had before and you only know them better. I was like, that's a great lesson because there are no wrong turns in development. I mean, you can go down a path and you realize like, oh God, this is not helping the story. But then you, if it doesn't work, great. There's save as. And so, so you can go back to what you had. And so he's just been amazing. I just sent him my new script cause I want his opinion on it. And he's been awesome.
Jesse, do you have a mentor?
I never had a mentor, but I have really, really good friends. And early on in my career, after Karina, Nora Ephron reached out and became a friend and just really supportive and really tough on me in a wonderful way.
Why do you think she did that? I mean, aside from the work being great, but you know, where's that impulse?
She does it with a lot of men and women. She just, I think her cup runneth over in that way, you know, that she has, she loves creativity, she loves supporting creativity, she has a gift for friendship, or she had a gift for friendship. And so I found that, you know, I've met people along the way that have been tremendously supportive. A lot of my close friends are filmmakers. Callie Corey, who wrote Thelma and Louise, is my daughter's godmother. So, I mean, there's... Oh, my God. So it's more out of friendship.
She was advocating for herself over here.
Yeah. So that's been more... The thing, there hasn't been one mentor, not that I wouldn't have wanted that, but that didn't come my way. But I have, over the years, run the Sundance Writers Lab, and it's been really important for me to reach out to young filmmakers and to be encouraging, because I know how much it meant to me along the way, and you can kind of spot them. And Lena Dunham was one of my students early on. You can kind of feel the ones that are gonna, you know, push their way through and all of that, but never one mentor, but a lot of support. I found women and men tremendously supportive. I haven't felt people not rooting for me, or even now with my film coming out, it was a weekend where three films came out by women filmmakers, which they've made such a big deal out of.
It's the weekend of women filmmakers, yay! Which one are you gonna choose? Because you don't have enough time to go to all of them because you've got all these other things.
But they've all been very supportive, and it's, you know, it's that myth that we're competitive or at each other's throats in some way is so absurd.
I want to get to one more topic here, and then we're going to open it up to some questions from all of you as you've gotten to know these fabulous women people up here. The topic of work-life balance, and sometimes the issue of scarcity because of availability, and the juggle that both men and women have, because working in the industry it's hard on families, it's hard on relationships, it's hard on your sleep, it's hard. How have you gone about balancing your needs as an individual person with the pressures of production, development, and just the industry as a whole? And sometimes I wonder, you know, maybe that is part of the problem. You know, maybe the sexism comes from this model of if you're gonna, you can have a career or you can have a family if you're gonna be in entertainment, but you can't have both. So who wants to jump in on that? Elise is nodding her head pretty heavily here.
Well, I think I would just...
Do you have children?
I do. I have two children. I have a daughter who's almost 13 and a son who's 10. And I have a husband who's here, who's a big part of how I was able to just, you know, run off to, you know, Australia and Singapore. And I did one film where we shot in like 11 different countries. I mean, I think it's very difficult. I think you need support. You know, you need kind of an infrastructure around you. So it's very helpful to have a partner. I also was lucky that my mom was close by. But I ended up working and doing a lot of films with a female director who's also a friend who also has two kids, Jessica Yu.
Oh, I love her.
Yeah. And, you know, and so we would, you know, figure out what we were doing, look at the production schedule, and we're like, well, you know, this is Ava's birthday, this is Esme's birthday, this is Stella's birthday, we cannot be away for Halloween, you know, you know, when I was working with male directors, that was not the case. It was like, we got to go here, drop everything, you know.
Do you think that's changing? Because, you know, there's certainly male directors who have fathers. I mean.
Yeah, I mean, these particular male directors had older kids, so it's probably not a fair analogy. But I think the point is that when Jessica and I were, you know, held the reins and we were able to kind of, you know, we both knew that, you know, we were emailing each other at midnight every night because, you know, but we would stop and go do what we needed to do. We trusted each other. We knew that both of us had, you know, an obsessive work ethic and we would never, you know, let the project suffer, but we also were going to be there for the important things that we needed to be there for. So I do think that the more you can be in control of, you know, your schedule, your process, the easier it is to have that balance. If you're completely at the mercy of, you know, somebody else, it's a lot harder. So the more you can kind of try to, you know, put yourself in a kind of decision-making process, the easier it's going to be, but it's always going to be hard.
Tess, as a young filmmaker, do you think about these things?
Like a cloud that hangs over your head in the dark, stormy afternoon. I mean, at this point in my career, I'm just like going as fast as I possibly can and not thinking about any of that. I'm sure that I'll cross those bridges when I come to them. And now I have like the adrenaline and bug to just go and go and go and go and go. So I feel like I'm in a lucky place.
But the work habits that you're developing, mm-hmm. and the culture of work that you're developing, you know, and the other people that maybe you're working with, did you think about Halloween? Did you think about someone's birthday?
How are those things that we can begin to
shift in the ways that we work that are inclusive?
I don't know. I don't know how to answer that question, really.
Okay, that's your
kind of, science. Yeah, that's my science. I didn't get that out. So my husband and I don't have kids. Well, he actually recently found out he has a 23-year-old. So wear a condom, everybody. I made a conscious decision to not have children because I knew I was far too selfish with my career and I didn't want to have to make that choice. So you know, I'm a better aunt anyway. Like, fill the kids up with sugar, teach them some bad words, and send them back. But I never had that instinct to be like, oh, suckle my teat.
I actually think that says it all, because it's not like there's one kind of woman director and then they have to balance work and family. There's just like men, there's some men that want to be around more and pick and choose jobs. There's some women that don't have that instinct. So again, this notion that all women are the same or that all men are the same, and it just drives me insane. But for me, having a child was really important. And for a while, when she was young, she was always on the set with me and basically always on my lap. And I always would try to give her a job. She actually cast Dakota Fanning in I Am Sam when she was 6. I made her look at all the tapes. And, wow. She's that one, mommy, that one. And but then as she got older, I realized it was too tough for me directing and being away from her so long. So I made a choice at one point to focus more on the writing, and I felt really lucky to have that. And then when she graduated and went out into the world, you know, kind of rose up in me a lot of wanting to direct again. So I kind of moved between writing, directing, and producing in different phases of her life. But for me, my trailer was always the daycare center, and everybody brought their kids there. I encouraged it, and And I think it's incredible to have kids on a set, so that was always a big part of directing for me. But I agree, you know, you have to have a real support team around you to do that.
I just thought, you know, what a concept if, like, you know, productions had childcare on them, you know, and that's one of the ways in the corporate workplace, you know, the best places to work have really good childcare. Whoa, where's the equivalent of that in the production world? You know, and that's an issue for mothers and fathers. And if you're working in production, there are not that many options for you. You know, there's a concept for production companies, right? Well, where's your daycare? Childcare. They take care of children, not days. Yeah, they pay for days, but that's another story. That's about budget.
But. Well, just in terms of myself, it's really about, I have two young children. I think if I were a filmmaker and having children, I'd probably pick my projects differently. It's outweighing, it's the balance in terms of what's important. It's about being socially conscious about the messaging behind the projects I would typically work on. So I think it makes us probably more self-aware. I think people with families are very busy and chaotic lives, especially women, we're forced to multitask. We don't have the choice. Like, the kids need to be picked up, fed, and tuition paid, alongside going to work for 12 hours and doing what we need to do. And I think it lends to a very different perspective as creators. So work-life balance, I think, we were made for that. This is what we do. And I think women are really good at it. We may be a little bananas at time and neurotic or whatever it is, but I think it's equivalent to passion, and it's equivalent to what we believe in. And when we speak up and we shout and we complain, we're the bitch. Or when the guy does it, it's, well, he has a specific perspective and he wants something and he's direct. But I think it's really about women being strong, sticking together, and having that balance and not apologizing for it at all.
Yeah, what is that balance? I mean, that's the magical balance.
I think that's I think the whole construct is a myth.
Yeah, I was going to say, I hate the construct that you can have it all. Like, that notion, like, whoop, poof, you can have it all. Right. I always think you can have it all, but maybe not exactly at the same time. Like, you can have a family, but maybe at certain points you'll be making choices to focus on them more than certain projects. Other times you'll throw yourself into a project. You'll have to maybe go back and do a little repair work on your family. You know, it's a constant challenge, and I think the more the dialogue can be, it isn't easy. It's messy. It's kooky. You know, it's,
and that's okay.
Yeah, you know.
And also, I mean, 50% of at least of women work. It's not. I mean, I feel like we're. You know, I often feel like I'm in a really fortunate position of having to make these choices. You know, I mean, so many women work. I feel like the systems have to change fundamentally to accommodate the reality that women work. So, I mean, we tend to take these on as personal problems, like, how am I going to figure it out? But I think ultimately it's, you know, I worked with this Swedish demographer, and we had to take up, you know, an hour and a half plane ride, and I was crying by the time we got to our destination because he was telling me what they do in Sweden, and men have to take 6 months off, and you're shamed if you don't, and mandatory daycare, and mandatory this, and I just thought, God, you know, we are so backwards in the U.S., and so much of Europe and other countries have it figured out so much better. So maybe if, you know, Hillary Clinton becomes president, yeah, I think we have to address these things not just on a personal level, and think it's my problem, it's my struggle, it's a systemic issue that has to be addressed.
Yeah. Damn it.
Thank you, I'm not the only one cursing.
I imagine there are some questions that need to be asked. There's someone back there and then over here. So we'll go back there, you,
take those mics
and the table. All the way in the back over there. Don't forget her in the dark over there. Raise your hand.
Oh,
yes. Back over there. We'll do you first, and then we'll hop to you, and we'll move around. But keep your hand up. Yeah.
Nice.
No, I don't have any background in the film industry, but I think the fact that you're even having this conversation today is brilliant from addressing these issues for women. But our son, he's studying film down in LA. So I'm wondering if he went to each and every one of you with a resume, would he be at a disadvantage or should he change his major?
No, he wouldn't be at a disadvantage at all. No. No, no.
So it seems like you'd consider women before you'd consider a male.
What characteristics would you look for? Would you? I mean, I think that part of, I hope you're hearing that, can you listen well? Can you work with other people? When your opinion is different than someone else's, are you able to compromise? You know, the reference that I made to my children in the robotics teams, these six girls and one boy, that boy is an amazing programmer. He has absolutely no emotional intelligence, okay? None. And these are, you know, 10, 12, 13-year-old kids. And what they're experiencing is this way of working. And it's amazing to me because the girls will just let him do his thing, but never at any point does he say, well, would you be interested in programming this? And I see yet another generation coming along. I mean, they're ready. They want to see. They, you know, my younger daughter, she wants to be an engineer. But she's still waiting for someone to say, hey, will you program this? What are the clues that she's getting? And she's my daughter. You know, I mean, she's getting a lot of it at home. Of, yes, you can. Yes, you can. You go show him. You go show everybody. You be yourself. What is it in the way that we work as people, men and women together, that we need to support each other? Because this is not some kind of female problem. You know, this is an economic problem. And also, like in the state of California, if we do not graduate from college, more Latinos, our economy in California in the next 5 years is going to contract by 11%. It will affect everybody. If we don't include 50% of the population in roles of developing content and all of the fabulous creative stuff, we don't really make that much hardware in the United States, but we make, you know, software content, what's going to happen to our economy? What's going to happen to the film industry? So how do we begin to learn to work with each other as a society, as a community, and value each other? It's hard work, you know? I mean, anyone else want to weigh in on that?
Well, I was just going to say to your question, many of the most valued members of my crew are men, you know, and I passionately love working with them. So I don't think there's any resistance, you know, from a lot of us. I do think there's a sense of being mindful to bring more women to the table, but if not to the exclusion of men. So I don't think. So stay in film school. You do it. And I think it's a very hard time for many men filmmakers right now, too. You know, it's the superhero time, the Marvel comic book movies are getting made. It's just a hard time to get other kinds of movies made.
Thank you so much for doing this. This is like a wonderful soup that you've all put in these wonderful ingredients.
She called us a soup.
A female soup. Great, I love it. So I'm a filmmaker here. I have a short film called Playdate. And I want to say that we've done 12 festivals, and often, you know, my last film has happened too, I'm standing up at the Q&A with five men, you know, 27-year-old white males, and me. And I love 27-year-old white men. I dated them many years ago. Now, at Napa Valley, and I think you were talking about this screening, Lisa, that was three of us out of six were females, and each of us had a female story. So I think it does start here with the programmers. I also think it's a grassroots movement. As me as a filmmaker, just like you all said, get out and make that film. So that's really empowering. I'm on the Women's Steering Committee. Jeannie, I've met you. I'm the DGA. I came up through the ranks as a documentary and reality show director. And then I had two babies, went away, because the hours were too much and I wanted the balance. I wanted to raise them. And now I'm coming back into narrative filmmaking. And it's hard, even with all this experience, being on the DGA, having two young girls, you know, I wanna create something that's meaningful and can change their lives as well. So I hear a lot of young filmmaker, and I think what I'm coming up against is how do I make the jump? I've made four short films. I have a feature that I've written. I'm also a writer, director, and I'm really trying to find that mentor, you know, but I think Tess might be the one that they want to mentor as a young filmmaker. I think there's a lot of ageism for women in this industry, like myself. And I'm a powerhouse. I get it done, and I know I have what it takes. But I also have children, and I have, you know, I also have a lot of experience, which I know helps me. But I guess my question is, what do you advise somebody in the middle of their career who's like right on that precipice and ready, has something to say, but you know, I'm up against the ageism as well. I mean, Jesse, when you say young filmmakers, do you mean young like starting, or do you mean young in numbers?
I meant starting, people starting their careers.
Thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, but what I would say to you is, just don't give up. Yeah. That's all that, you know, if you give up, it won't happen. So just don't give up. I mean, because it is hard, and it often takes years. And as I said, I never found a mentor. So I think, you know, that can sometimes not happen. But I remember my agent on Carina, sent me the 250 no's, a grid of all the passes, and then the one yes. And the company that ultimately said yes had said no three times. But I do think if you can get actors attached to your material, through friends, through whatever, then often, you know.
It's easier.
Yeah.
Because, that no turns into a yes very quickly.
Yeah, because I Am Sam got passed a lot on until Sean Penn was attached, and even then some people passed. But, you know, it's, they don't trust their own instincts, so if someone else has validated you, often they'll go, oh, well, okay, maybe that is worthwhile. So I would try to package your material and get a few actors involved, and that's often how it can push through, and often it's easier to find them than it is, you know, financing.
And also, just when it's on the page, it doesn't matter. Like, if it's good, it will get noticed. So, what was your name again?
My name is Paige.
Paige.
Exactly.
So, you know, like, it could be an interesting experiment. Written by Robert, you know, like if you feel like that is working against you, do a pen name or something like that. But to me, it doesn't, because I don't look at the cover page anyway when I'm reading scripts. I just want to know what is there, what's the story, who are the characters.
I think more than my name, you know, being female writing it, I think it is a female perspective. I'm committed to writing stories about women, and I think it's a little soft. It's not edgy. It's not like Sundance. You know, it's not what they're looking for necessarily in this climate right now. So that may be what's working against me more. But it is getting noticed. It's just, are they going to make it?
So that issue of ageism, because I think that's something that men and women both acutely feel, you know, that the entertainment industry is a youth industry. And you do want someone who physically can work 14, 16-hour days on things. And, you know, quite frankly, when you get older and wiser, you're not necessarily working longer is not necessarily better, and you learn that as you get older. But you know, how do you all deal with ageism? I mean, in all of the roles that you play and represent in your professional work, Elise, you want to?
I don't think it's a huge factor for what I do, honestly. Except if ageism is equated with kind of out of style. Like, I found myself, you know, looking at a piece of material the other day, and it was really interesting to me, and the filmmakers were very, very seasoned. And I did catch myself thinking, is this gonna be like boring, you know, like old school documentary, you know? But then I was like, well, no, you know. But I think it factors in a little bit, but I think that, you know, I look around at the people I'm working with, and everybody's, you know, earned their place in their position. Mm-hmm. You know, it just takes time to build a career and to gain the experience. And I think that there's a wisdom that comes from the experience that you just can't trade that.
So I don't feel like in, you know, in my particular world.
That's that much of an issue.
No, sorry.
Jeannie?
I think in television the problem is there's too many old people. So, you know, we want the young, fresh perspective, and that's hard to penetrate when we have, especially in network television, where a lot of our showrunners tend to be a little bit older. They hire who they know, and they recycle, and they use the same type of directors, which I totally get. It's a matter of minimizing risk, right? So if you're going to minimize risk, I'm going to hire her because we've been working together for 30 years, or whatever it is. So how do we jump over that obstacle? And I think it's finding mentors who believe in it, who believe in you, aside from what age you are, old or young. In our director's program, we have young directors shadow on 4 or 5 of our network shows to help minimize the risk. Like, they're able to direct, but the longer you're on set, the more comfortable we become with you, and the less risk adverse you become. I mean, and it really has nothing to do with if you can block a scene or your shot list is really good. You know, it's really about the longer you're there, they're more comfortable. If a director falls out, she's the next person I'm gonna be like, fight for Paige. So it's very much about that. The same with the writers program. We read blindly. We read 1,600 scripts in May, and they're all blind. Black out the names. What's the story about? If it's compelling, if the narrative moves me, if it's something that there's a brand that I could jump off of, it's somebody that I'm willing to put my reputation on the line for, and calling an agent and manager, bring them in. So in terms of ageism, we want young. We want we want young, fresh perspectives, but that's definitely a challenge for us when we have television directors working in TV for the past 30 years. And then there's the cable aspect. Like, I'll call Showtime and be like, why are the numbers so bleak when it comes to television directors of color? Because they want people from the independent feature world, which is great for you all. Now it's just making sure that there's a pipeline so that you can go direct an Affair or Ray Donovan or, you know, an HBO show. It's like, where's the pipeline? How are we feeding in young, fresh, diverse and non-diverse talent into these places that are looking for content? I mean, the content has exploded relative to 5-10 years ago. There's always a demand for content. So as an independent feature maker, like, continue at your craft. You just need to find a place where it's gonna find a platform and a home. And that's what all these networks try and do in terms of all their different programs. But in terms of ageism, like, fuck it, just continue at it. You know, just push at it, and don't let it be your crutch, but let it be your sword. Like,
when you're saying young, do you mean like age young or new?
New
perspectives.
Yes. And young in terms of how things are shot and the amount of technology out there that maybe a 60 or 70 year old director wouldn't be savvy to. So I think opening it up and not asking permission to open up to new perspectives is really important. But that's hard. I mean, it's hard. Industry likes what it likes. How do you change that?
I think you had a question?
Yes. This is for Tess, and I had kind of a similar question for you too, Kristen, but you already answered it.
Oh.
Thank you. Tess, in your film, It's Perfect Here, it's a beautiful story between a brother and a sister. When you were writing it, did you ever consider between two sisters?
Oh, I never did, not until this very moment, but that's because I have a brother.
I'm available for consulting.
I'll call you. That's because I have a brother, so that was what was familiar to me, and that was where the conflict came from. But it would work with two sisters, absolutely.
And it was your brother in the film as well.
Yeah.
And visually, it's very nice to look at that.
Huh.
You know, that similarity.
You had a question.
Hi. I think it's been really great listening to the directors who are women talk about telling women's stories and how important it is. And I completely agree. I'm the national director of SAG Indy, so I spend my days helping independent filmmakers make film. But we talked a little bit, you mentioned Trevor, and I'm wondering how we also help the directors who are coming up get into the conversation about the bigger movies, where you get somebody who made a tiny film get handed Jurassic World, and you get the writer who wrote Pride and Prejudice and Zombies get handed a $100 million film, having never directed even a short. And the discussion was, well, you know, girls don't like dinosaurs. Which is a ridiculous thing, since 50% of the audience were women. So how do we start getting the conversation to be that we love telling women's stories and there's a valid, good amount of women's stories, but also that all stories are women's stories? Like, we like everything. We can do sci-fi, we can do anything. How do we get people to stop going, girls don't like?
Yeah, that's a big societal stereotype issue that we kind of have to deal with. I think also, you know, and another element of that, and Elise, you might talk about this a little bit, and the global marketplace that represents, you know, box office, you move outside of Europe and you move outside of the North America, there is still such an overwhelming degree of sexism. An absolute lack of interest. Women are invisible. You know, the global marketplace, I think, has an impact on whether a story can sell or not. And so the stories that are told with the big budgets tend to be stories that can also do well overseas. Okay, so how do we make stories about women, not women's stories, but stories about women as compelling commercially? How do you do that? That's hard.
Well, I think you're talking about something else.
The statistics say that when women are directors or people of color directors, their cast, their crew, immediately follow the response of the director. It becomes a more integrated and equal group of people who are in front of behind the camera. So it's not necessarily a woman's story in space, although I think women would do very well in space. I think that big space movies now have, you know, Sandra Bullock in it. So that's not so much it, is that we can make them. We can control the money. It's as if they say, well, if we give $100 million to a female director, she's gonna spend, you know, 50 of it on shoes and purses. It's like, what on earth? We handle everything. So why can't we be in that conversation where it's an immediate dismissal of, well, you know, she made a $3 million film, she can't handle 50, but safety not guaranteed was maybe 2, and the next one was 100. We have to start being able to take on bigger and bigger, and I don't know how to
push the dial.
Yeah.
Any thoughts about pushing the dial?
Well, I think it's important to break the myth of a woman's picture. You know, I think when Catherine Bigelow won the Oscar for Hurt Locker, you go, well, that's not a typical woman's picture. Right. You know, when Catherine Hardwick, you know, some of the movies she makes, it's just ludicrous to think that women want to tell only women's stories and women's pictures. You know,
what is a women's story, you know?
To me, they want to tell good stories and interesting stories and stories that reflect our world. And, you know, so this notion that women want to make chick flicks or something, like, I think that's, even this weekend, Patricia's movie's coming out about the Chilean miners.
Yeah.
There's a Hispanic woman directing that film. Wouldn't typically be a woman's picture. So I think we've got to get that myth busted, you know, that women tend to want to make those kinds of movies. And
but then Quentin Tarantino came out and said, oh, well, Catherine won because she was a woman. It's like, so you get it from both sides, because then he's reinforcing the stereotype, and now all the guys are like, oh, yeah, he's right. Like, she made a fucking great movie.
Yeah.
And that could have just as easily been, he made a really good movie. She's a director. And so, yeah, it's frustrating. And
I think the market just needs to be penetrated with really good women. So the option is, instead of 2 women versus 10 men, and they pick one, like, it's 5 women and 5, like, and pick the best one. But I think the inventory needs to increase, and there needs to be a pipeline for them to succeed, the good ones to succeed, because they represent us to some degree. But I think studios and large companies want the best person. We just need to provide that inventory. Aside from saying what's wrong with and why aren't they directing the big dinosaur movie, go do a dinosaur movie. Like, I think it's more of how do we change what the makeup looks like in terms of the list? Like, what's the list look like? There's two really good women and eight, there is a problem there. And how do we increase that number? We want the best women, we want the best director. And once the inventory starts looking a little bit differently, I think decisions will start changing in our favor.
Back over there. It's a little bit hard to see with this light, so if there's anyone over here, just flag down.
I was wondering if you think that there's a difference in the representation of women in the documentary world versus the narrative world. I just finished at the doc program at Berkeley, and the class was 80% women.
Yeah.
And my film was an all-women crew, and so was two or three other films that came out of that program.
Yeah.
Or is this kind of maybe a shifting thing that's happening?
No, it is. There are definitely more women represented in documentary, and if you ask those women directors, they'll say because it's easier. You know, the stakes are lower, the budgets are lower. But you know, there are. I mean, I think Women in Film has done some interesting studies too about diversity. But I mean, you take someone like Jessica Yu, who I mentioned before, who's done a lot of documentaries, but she also has been in. She directs television, and she also directs commercials, and she does some narrative features. So she leveraged her success in documentary into these other areas. So I think that there are a lot more women represented, but the challenge becomes jumping out of that if you want to move to narrative. But you can, I do think that it's a good way to, because there are more opportunities to maximize them, and then just try to figure out again these pipelines, like how do I take this, and people are so literal, like if you do this, you can't do this, and you know. So I think you're fighting against just more the genre jump than the gender jump in that instance.
Over here? Oh, you've got a microphone. Yeah, there you go. Okay, you're wearing that volunteer shirt, so I can't.
Yeah, sorry, volunteer. Yeah. So thank you so much for being here. Two questions. First one, it's like I'm a first time director, and I'm working on a screenplay right now. So when you're talking about the diversity program at CBS, it seems like, okay, this catch me too. Like, okay, how do I get experience? Like, do I just do it myself, and then like hope that like that's kind of my calling card thing, or should I like PA and like work my way up? It's kind of like, how do I get that first shot sort of thing? And then the second question is, I feel like at least on Twitter, for me anyway, I see so many articles from like Vulture and Variety being like, this is a literal list of 100 women directors to hire them. Like, so everyone's like, oh, there's not enough out there. It's like, well, here's a list. I think Women in Film has one. I feel like there's lists all over the place. And yet people are like, yeah, I don't know. So like, what do you think, what are your thoughts on those lists? Are they effective? Like, what's going on there?
I have lists. We have a lot of lists. No, but in terms of the director's program, as a young director, our director program requires you to be DGA, but across the board, NBC doesn't, and I believe ABC doesn't as well. Warner Brothers has a director's program, as does Sony and Fox. So absolutely, and look into all those different programs in terms of, and it's not, some of them are about to, like Bethany Rudy does a workshop at Warner Brothers, it's about teaching, and some of them are just to provide you access. And that's what you need as filmmakers, is access and mentorship. So that's what the program stands for. Our director program doesn't teach, but it provides you shadowing opportunities so you can spend, you know, 3 weeks on set of Madam Secretary and get to know the players there, and figure out how they play in that sandbox relative to Hawaii Five-O and NCIS Los Angeles. Like, just figuring out the nuance of how the temperament of that show works. So that's really important. And in terms of the list, yes, there are a ton of lists, but the idea that there's a list that a magazine or a trade magazine needs to publish it is a little bit absurd, right? Because there's not a list of 100 men you can pick from. So I think it's really about, these lists exist. We're definitely trying to move the dial in the right place. And these lists should eventually not exist. It should just be a standard operating procedure when it comes to hiring directors. Just like there should, like, these programs shouldn't necessarily exist, right? Once we're at parity, like, it should just be part of the business. And that's what we're trying to work towards.
Jeannie, can you explain how people can apply or get it? How do those programs work?
Every network's website, cbsdiversity.com, ABC, NBC, Warner, like I said, Warner Brothers. And the DGA is doing a ton more outreach just because, you know, the cages have been rattled in terms of.
And they have annual application deadlines?
Yes.
And it's something that you.
Yep. ABC's this year, I think they're in October, they do theirs every 2 years. But we work collaboratively. Like, I'll call ABC and be like, what was this director like? We're looking for a director. So we work, it's really about moving the dial more than it is about their program versus our program. We're just trying to make a difference in terms of increasing the pool of women and diverse directors in television.
Two more questions. Got one. And then afterwards, we're moving out into the hallway because this theater does need to be cleared.
I'm Jean's husband, so we talk about it all the time at home. But we always talk about, like, when I was in film school, it's almost piggybacking off of her, and then I'm probably a lot older. When I was in film school, it was mainly male. Unfortunately, it didn't reflect society, it reflected more of what I see in the industry now, where it's so male dominated, but so is film schools. Like, it was probably like 70-80% male, and the diversity was like nothing. Like, maybe 2-3% of my classes are male or female. And like, in my film, I had to go out of my way to cast diverse, and it was hard to find, you know, different ways to do that, because it just wasn't, you know, a lot of people coming up. So I'm wondering, like, culturally, how do we change the film school dynamic where we can say it's okay as a female or a minority to go to film school and not, you know, just it's okay that you can have a career in the business. So I think, like, bottom up, I think, is what we need to populate the film schools with. How do we change that culturally?
I think there's some good examples of what was done in medical schools for how to support that. I don't think that film's a little slow to the party on that. I'm speaking as someone who's in higher ed and worked in higher ed. Things change very slowly in higher ed, and you're beginning to see a lot of explosive situations around the country where issues of overt and not so overt racism are finally being dealt with, and you're seeing a lot of chancellors and presidents of colleges resign. But at the same time, the next generation, you know, how many senior administrators and presidents of colleges and chancellors are female? You know, that's going to be shifting too, and it takes time. But I think those kind of questions and that kind of conversation is really important. Anyone else want to weigh in on that in terms of, you know, film school? Film school's only one route to being a director too. I mean, I think that Jesse, you really said, you know, you do your work, you put it out there, and you don't take no for an answer.
Yeah, there's also Sundance is a great, for any age. They have a writer's program, they have a director's program, a producer's program.
Yeah.
The women's program at AFI.
Yeah, Tribeca also, and IFP.
Yeah, if you sort of troll the internet, there's a lot of roads in that also aren't, I didn't go to film school, so I mean, there's other ways. And also the great thing about our world now is with these iPhones, you can make a film. You know, like anybody can make a film. And I always think, like, make a film. Like, let it be your calling card. Make a short, you know, like, and that's how you learn how to direct, really, is making a film. You know, by the end of the film, you go, oh, that's how, you know, the next film, you go, oh, you know, that's how you work. So I always encourage people to do that, you know, to get a calling card. And because you don't need a lot of money right now to make a short film, which is a great thing.
I think that we're going to need to move out of this room here. Hang on one second.
She really has a question.
I think that one of the things that you need to keep doing is coming to panels like this. And I want to thank all of you for being part of this conversation
this morning.
So that's me. Let's see if we can.
So thanks again, ladies, for being here. It's great for you to take the time. Really appreciate it. So my question is really, when it comes to your work, right? So, do you find that your work is often branded as female first, even if, again, you know, we talked about being into the female story or not, but regardless of that, are you finding that that is branded that way? And if so, how do you think about that? Do you think that's a good thing, a bad thing? So, for example, our brand is Crisis. Whenever I read an article about that film, the very first thing they come up and they say is, oh, Sandra Bullock turned this character from a male character into a female character. And so it brands it in a certain way for me, no pun on the title, but it brands that film. Your perspective on how you're going to think about it before you even see the film. Do you find that? And again, just how do you, how do you think about that for the work that you do?
Gran, I know you've got some thoughts on that.
Yeah, no, I mean, I as a writer, definitely, because I did sell a lot of rom-coms, and God bless them, they helped buy our house, but I knew I didn't want to direct a rom-com, because then I would be labeled a chick director. I purposely sought out a story that had a male lead. The very graciously Variety named me as one of their top 10 directors to watch last year, and the next day I got 13 rom-com submissions. I was like, fuck off, you know, so I passed on all of them, and I waited for something to actually move me, and I was purposely looking for a male story. I ended up finding something about a female Marine that touched my heart, and so I was like, you know what, I don't care, I'm going to do this because it's special. And if somebody wants to say, oh, it's a female story, I'll tell them to go fuck themselves. Because it's just a beautiful story. So I am conscious of it. It exists 100%. And I think that you just have to do stuff that means something to you. And if it turns out it's a female story or even a rom-com, God bless. But I feel the bias.
Thank you all so much for being here. And filmmakers, encourage you to really continue having these conversations at other events in the festival. And I think the photographer's trying to get us all to come together.
Okay.
Okay. Kristen.